सदाकतें इस्लाम कुछ भी हो जाएंगे हम जहां भी के जाना पड़े हमें जाएंगे हम जहां भी के जाना
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another live beacon of truth. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied during his lifetime that when the Messiah would appear, during that Messiah, when he would appear, he would appear in a time when nothing would be left of Islam but its name, and nothing would be left of the Quran but its script. And also during his lifetime, he instructed the Muslims to, whenever that Messiah would appear, to go and convey his salam to him and to perform the oath of initiation, i.e. the bayath, at his hand. And he paid great emphasis on this point. So it's wrong to say that there was never a need for this Messiah to appear. And this is something which Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih V, may Allah strengthen his hand, in his recent Friday sermon on the 19th of April 2013, paid great emphasis on, that there was a need for this Messiah to appear. So when we've established that there was the need for this Messiah to appear, and when we recognized a claimant for this Messiahship, then a natural question would arise then that, well, what did this Messiah do? What did this claimant of Messiahship do? Inshallah, this is what we will look at, what Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib alayhi salatu wasalam of Qadian, what he did and how he, what services he rendered for humanity at large and for Islam as well. Because after all, we do say that he did so much, all that which no one did in the last 1400 years. And obviously we have to fully understand what he did and try to fully comprehend these services in order to appreciate the services, the grand services of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, in the true sense. And that's inshallah what we shall be doing today in today's program. We have with us here Abdul Quddus Arif Sahib, Shahzad Ahmed Sahib and Farhad Ahmed Sahib. As always, this is a live and an interactive platform which has been made for the viewers at home. So if you have any questions, comments, queries with regards to today's topic of preferably, or various other topics, we'll be more than welcome to take them on board. Inshallah, we will include them in our program today. Shahzad Sahib, I'd like to start off with you. If you can please tell us, was there really any corruption during the time of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib alayhi salatu wasalam, prior to his advent?
Well, Qasid, from the Holy Quran, we find that whenever there appears any corruption or chaos or disorder in the world, Allah the Almighty, out of His infinite grace and mercy, sends His prophets. Now, these prophets, not only do they bring about a spiritual transformation and give a moral code of conduct of life, but they also re-establish the true concept of Tawheed, i.e. the oneness of God. And through that, they bring about a transformation and rid the world of various idolatrous practices and customs that they're in. Now, when we take a look at the time close to the advent of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, we find that despite the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stating that for your guidance I have left the Quran and my Sunnah, despite this fact, the Muslims were indulged in all sorts of innovations. All kinds of innovations had crept into Islam. And to name a few, for instance, that even are prevalent in today's society, Muslim world as well, is, for instance, prostrating at graves or holding various saints as intercessors, and various other rituals and customs that are practiced so often in at times of weddings and funerals, which actually stem from the Hindu culture. Now, all of these innovations are actually directly or indirectly forms of shirk. That is why the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam very strictly spoke against these, and very strongly, in strong words, spoke about various innovations. And he had said that kullu bid'atin dhalala wa kullu dhalala finnar, that every kind of bid'at is a misguidance, and all misguidance is in the hellfire. Now, the Muslims were not only indulged in all kinds of innovations, but with time their very basic and fundamental principles and beliefs had also become distorted. For instance, the book, the Holy Quran, that which we regard as the most perfect book, that is the source of guidance and wisdom for all of mankind and is free from all kinds of defects. Regarding the same book, there were Muslims that were of the idea, of the view, that many of its verses had now been abrogated and were not applicable. In fact, some of these scholars had verses almost several hundred, even 1,000 verses, which they thought that were abrogated. And then there was a section of the Muslims who placed so much emphasis on hadith as the source of guidance that they regarded it, God forbid, superior to the Holy Quran. Then on the other end of the spectrum, there were those who gave so much emphasis to the Quran that they completely disregarded the ahadith. Then again, with the passage of time, one of the very dangerous concept that the Muslims started to entertain was the physical ascension of Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and believed that he was going to come back to the world as a Messiah for the Muslims in his physical form. Now, not only is this completely against the teachings of the Holy Quran, but in fact it allowed the Muslims to play right in the hands of the Christians. And so many Muslims were actually leaving Islam and entering the fold of Christianity. Then another, the corruption that had appeared was the commentary that these various so-called scholars were doing at that time, and the interpretation that they had of the Holy Quran. And these commentaries were actually nothing short of a complete mockery and disrespect to religion. There's various examples which we'll talk about later as well. For instance, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, Hazrat Lut alayhi salam, all of these prophets of God, and they did not even spare the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They made such interpretation that was going against and disrespecting the noble status of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So as we mentioned in the previous program as well, that the time in which the advent of the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam took place was the time when Islam needed a savior. It needed someone to champion the cause of Islam more than ever. And many people recognized this, that many people felt this need. That's why people like Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab, people like Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, Jamaluddin Afghani, and so on and so forth, these people arose in their efforts.
Yeah.
Because the reason was because there was the West was introducing itself to the East, there was the development of science and technology, and in response to that the Muslims had nothing to offer. They had confined themselves to mere rituals, superstitious beliefs and magical thinking, so they had nothing to offer. They seemed backward in front of this Western ideology. So like I said, we see many reform movements at that time coming about. But although their thought was right, the intention was right, but the method or the implementation was wrong. As a result of that, today we cannot even pray, raise our hands at the blessed grave of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because of the overly strict approach of Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab.
It was just two ends of the spectrum, basically.
It was two ends of the spectrum, absolutely, you're right. Because on the other side, we see that when Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan established the Aligarh movement, now although we give him due credit that he did serve Islam, but having said that, he compromised some of the most basic tenets of Islam, such as prayers and angels. So when we look at it in light of this, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam's efforts were completely unique and stood alone, because he established the superiority of Islam, the teachings of Islam, the need of the Quran, and the superiority of its teachings. He presented a living faith, he presented a living God. He said that the God that spoke to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam 1400 years ago, or 2000 years ago, to Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam and all the prophets before him, speaks to me today, and he will speak to you too. So he presented a living faith. So this is one of the greatest service that Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam rendered towards Islam. And that's why, for instance, these topics, this establishing the superiority of Islam, the Quran, and proving that God is a living God of Islam, is in fact the gist of what his epic book, the masterpiece of his, was Rahine Ahmadiyya. See, many people often ask that many scholars wrote books. What's so different about Rahine Ahmadiyya? This is it. This was the need of the time. This was a time when the very existence of God, the teachings of Islam, the character of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was under great attack. And Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam was the only person who gave a sound and solid response. That is why even the opponents of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam were compelled to say that this is one of the greatest services rendered by anyone in the 1400 years of Islam, in the history of Islam.
Jazakallah, Shahzad Sahib. And obviously you mentioned about some of the, before you mentioned about the Promised Messiah, you mentioned some of the corruptions and the innovations which were taking place in society at that time, and inshallah we'll be answering those in the program just shortly. We have received a comment from Bilal Sahib from Nigeria, and it's just the first 10 minutes, but Bilal Sahib, mashallah, has, alhamdulillah, sent a message in. He is saying that we are watching and enjoying your program. Thank you. So I'd like to convey that to the panelists, mashallah. Alhamdulillah, you're doing a great job. Jazakallah for that, Bilal Sahib, and obviously to all the rest of the viewers also. If you do have any questions, any queries, then please, well, you know what to do. The contact details are being shown on the screen. This program is primarily for, well, aimed at the youth, because it has the youth within the program. But obviously, any other people who wish to ask their questions, inshallah, will be more than welcome. We'll be more than happy to answer your questions or accommodate your comments, queries, or whatever you have to convey to us, inshallah. We will include that in today's program. Jazakumullah for that, Bilal Sahib. Qudusab, as Shahzad mentioned, there were some false beliefs and notions regarding the Holy Quran. If you can please enlighten us and tell us what these were and how Hazrat Mirza Sahib alayhi salatu wasalam responded to these.
Yeah, Jazakumullah Qasid. As Shahzad mentioned, many things with regards to the Quran, how the Quran itself was being misinterpreted and verses of the Quran were being misinterpreted. The first thing I would like to mention that Shahzad also stated is with regarding Nasikh and Mansukh, which means the abrogating or abrogated verses of the Quran. As Shahzad mentioned, that this very concept started to creep within the Muslim Ummah at a very early age, in the few early centuries of Islam itself. And we find that many, many different schools of thoughts, you know, regarded up to 1100 verses of the Quran to be abrogated. Then there were some who used to say it was 200, some would say 20, as in Jalaluddin Asyuti Sahib, he said there's 20 verses of the Quran which are abrogated, and some contemporary scholars had said that there were 7. But there was still a difference in opinion, and even today we find that this difference of opinion still exists. Whereas we find that the Promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, alayhi salatu wasalam, who was a true champion of Islam, who was a true champion of the Quran itself, he stated that not a single verse of the Quran is abrogated and can be abrogated. Forget a verse, not even a single letter or a single stroke of the Quran is abrogated from the Quran. We find that, as Shahzad mentioned, that the ideology of the life and death of Jesus and Mary alayhi salatu wasalam was also being questioned, and Muslim scholars used to present their argumentation from the Quran, where you find that the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, he proved from the Quran, of course, being a divine, being someone who's been divinely guided and was divinely commissioned, he proved from the Holy Quran and the Ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, including books of history and books of medicine, that Jesus son of Mary alayhi salatu wasalam did not ascend to the heavens as is believed by normal Muslims, but he migrated after crucifixion towards Kashmir and died at the age of 120 or 125. And Azul proved this all from the Holy Quran itself. Again, getting rid of this wrong ideology, wrong belief of the Muslim Ummah, whereas they believe that Jesus son of Mary alayhi salatu wasalam did not even, you know, was hung on the cross itself, but was safeguarded by Allah, exalted by his ascension. And as Shahzad mentioned, that this was such a belief within the Ummah that actually pointed fingers and raised questions against the Prophet of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his exalted status. Christians will say that you claim that your Prophet is meant to be the most exalted Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but we find that our Christ, our Lord, has been given a much greater status in Islam itself.
There's that verse, that couplet as well of the Promised Messiah, ke ghairat ki jaa hai isa zinda ho asman mein madfoon ho zameen mein shah jahan hamara, that it doesn't behove us to say that Jesus, son of Mary, who was a humble prophet of God Almighty, he's up in the heavens, but the master, the chief of all the prophets, Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is buried in the ground.
Azul so clearly states in many places that the life of Islam is within the actual death of Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is true. If the Muslim Ummah even accepts today the death of Jesus, son of Mary alayhi salatu wasalam, all their problems will be resolved. Because then the Christians cannot turn around and say that, hold on, you are waiting that Messiah who's meant to be our Lord as well, so why don't you just accept Christianity in itself? So again, this was a great service that has rendered for the Holy Quran, for Islam itself. Another point that Shahzad mentioned was the status of the Quran, the status of Ahadith, and the status of Sunnah. It is unfortunate to say that at the time of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, even today, those who have not accepted the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, they regard Sunnah and Ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam as one, not differentiating between the two at all. They claim that Ahadith and Sunnah are of the same category. Whereas we find, some even say that Sunnah and Hadith are not important at all, it is just merely the Quran that we should focus upon.
They completely shun the Quran and the Ahadith altogether.
Absolutely, they've completely disregarded. But and it's vice versa as well. So we find that the Prophet Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, he stated that the primary source of Islam is the Quran, and it is the perfect book, it's the perfect word of Allah the Exalted, without any mistakes and without any interpolation. And the secondary source is the Sunnah, i.e. the conduct and actions of the Prophet ﷺ that illustrate the teachings of the Holy Quran, and they actually manifest the teachings of the Holy Quran itself. And it's a practical example given by the Prophet ﷺ so that we as Muslims know exactly what to do with each and every commandment of the Holy Quran. And Hazur said that the third source of guidance for the Muslim Ummah is the Ahadith of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, and you cannot disregard them either. Even if some hadith which we consider to be unauthentic, but if it does not go against the Quran, if it does not go against the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no matter how discreditable we consider it, it's worth following. And there are other examples as well that Hazur with regards to his service for the Holy Quran itself. Just to mention a few, just list a few, that some people used to say that there are certain parts of the Quran that have not been published at all. Hazur disregarded this notion completely as well. Some used to say that that today there can be no person who can receive divine insight. Hazur alayhi salatu wasalam presented himself as a person who received divine insight. In Arabic we call it mu'arif, that these divine insights, the divine knowledge was received by the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, and he challenged anyone of his contemporaries, and he said that if you would like to see these insights and knowledge of the Quran, then come to Qadian and I'll show them to you. Another thing that Hazur rejected was that people used to say that the historical facts mentioned within the Quran are unfortunately contrary to historical facts itself. Whereas the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam gave such a simple answer. He said that Allah the Exalted, his attribute is Alimul Ghaib, the knower of the unseen. Whatever he has said, stated in the Quran, that history is the correct history, and nothing else has any legs to stand upon, because they can have doubts because they are done by human minds. So there are many other wrong beliefs as well concerning the Quran, but of course in the program we will be discussing them further.
I see you've got a massive list in front of you, but inshallah we will be including those in our program, inshallah. Jazakallah for that. In fact, I actually understood from that the Promised Messiah alayhi wasalam didn't shun anything. He tried to prove, he proved everything to be true. Just as Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih IV said once, ki hum manne walon mein se hain, that we're from among the ones who accept. We try to accept everything and prove it to be truthful instead of negating it and completely, outright shunning it. So Jazakallah for that, Qudus Sahib. Farhad Sahib, we also heard from Shehzad Sahib that there were some innovations prevalent in Islam at that time. If you can please tell us how the Promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, alayhi salatu wasalam, how he sought to rid Islam of these innovations.
Well, Shahzad mentioned that a lot of innovations had entered Islam and seeped into Islam at the time of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, within the Muslims, which were actually leading them towards idolatry and shirk, which was exactly the thing the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam came to rid of. But we see that even if we look at in the subcontinent, where the Hindus, who are the followers of the most extreme form of shirk, i.e. idolatry, they worship idols, even they realized that the shape of the Muslims today is not very different to the Hindus. They realized that the Muslims, what they are doing is actually idol worship, in other words. For instance, a poet, Hindu poet, he said that if Hindus are idolaters because they worship idols and they bow down in front of idols, Muslims are bowing down in front of graves. So he realized, and that was absolutely true, Muslims were actually doing the exact same thing that the Hindus were doing at that time. And because the Hindus regarded the idols as intercessors for them, between them and God, and that's why they bowed down in front of them, that's exactly what the Muslims regarded the graves as. They regarded the graves as intercessors between them and God, and they thought that they couldn't reach God unless it was through those saints buried in those graves.
I suppose they considered themselves so humble that they didn't consider themselves worthy enough to supplicate before
God. And because of them not accepting the promised Messiah, we see that today that exact same thing is going on today. Mm. In fact, it has gone to another level. I mean, even today we see that the greatest scholars who claim to be the greatest scholars of Islam, they've gone a step further. And rather than the graves being their intercessors, the scholars are claiming that we are the intercessors for the people buried in graves. And you can see a lot of videos on internet where you see these scholars actually talking to the graves and helping them pass the test, as it were, to enter heaven. And it makes you feel sorry for those people who actually believe and follow these great scholars, whom they believe to be great scholars, I guess. But shirk among the Muslims is not restricted to only grave worship. There's many other things. So many concepts have seeped into Islam which also amount to shirk and idolatry. For instance, concepts such as tasawwur al-shaykh, which means that you imagine your shaykh, whoever your scholar is, and you use him to help you get closer to God Almighty, even though he may not be alive. So this, you know, this need for establishing an intercessor between human beings and God Almighty, that's exactly what idolatry was, and that's exactly what the Muslims were doing at that time. And then there were many people who would go to a lot of fakirs and so-called holy people, and they would get a lot of words from them, a lot of scripts from them, and they would rely upon those, and they would read out those many times, and they would rely upon those as though they were the replacement of God Almighty, and they thought that these words are the ones that have the power, and from them we can solve all our problems. And then you also had the Sufis, many Sufis who had taken the wrong meaning of Sufism, and they were actually some of them were repeating the word of God, the name of Allah, repetitively, and they danced along as well, and music, and they actually were resembling just exactly what the Christians, some of the Christians were doing in their churches, dancing to the extent that you lose all senses. That's not what Islam came for. And the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, came and told that you initializing something within Islam, making something, innovating something within Islam, is in other words saying that the Sharia that we have been given by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not enough for us. We need something more. It is not a complete Sharia. That's what you're saying, in other words. That's what the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam told them. And the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam established a community and told them that you can reach God Almighty without without any intercessors in between. Allah says, "Ud'uni astajib lakum," that pray to me and I will answer your prayers. You do not need anyone in between. And the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam established a community which followed the precepts of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the ones that the practice established by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and brought them back to the initial, to the most basics of Islam. And that was the Salat, for instance. A lot of misconceptions about the Salat, the five daily prayers, had also been taking root within Islam. For instance, a companion of the Promised Messiah alaihi wasallam came to the Promised Messiah alaihi wasallam and said that there's some people who offer their Salat very quickly, but afterwards they sit down for a long time, long periods of time, and make their prayers then. The promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam found this very strange, and he said that it's like a person goes into a palace of a king but stays quiet and comes out and then starts making requests. Mm. So the promised Messiah alayhi salam said that this is exactly what Salat is. You are getting a chance to pray to God Almighty and yet you're not availing that. Mm. And then there's of course many other customs which the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam has ended, for instance to do with marriages, where people hold up the Holy Quran over the bride's head when she's leaving, which was exactly what the Hindus done with their books as well for their brides. And also with regards to at funerals, the excessive wailing and innovations within the Muslims with regards to funerals, we see that the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam established a community which he rid of all these innovations. And it would be wrong to say that the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, we still see these innovations around the world, therefore he hasn't done anything. The thing is, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam also caused a reformation. But did Abu Jahl take benefit from it? Of course not. Only those people benefit from the reformation caused by the Prophet are the ones that are part of his community and accept him. And that's what we see with our community, alhamdulillah, that we are away from these innovations that have seeped into other Muslims.
JazakAllah for that, Farhad Sahib. And I think when we spoke about the Sufis who, you know, dance to, you know, the whatever they danced to, and you know, in accordance with what the Hindu custom was. I don't think we're not talking about the Sufi sages at that time. We're not talking about the people who were the, you know, the pure pious people. We're talking about that specific group of people who were accustomed to doing these things. Jazakumullah for that, Farhad. So we've received quite a number of questions now, namely Imtiazuddin Sahib, Zafar Sahib, and Anisa Sahiba. Anisa Sahiba from Uganda, in fact, she has texted us in her comment in Swahili, and our control room, in fact, translated that. So Jazakallah for the control room to translate that. She says that, Jazakallah, I am enjoying your program. Jazakallah for that, Anisa Sahiba. And again, another reminder for all those viewers who are watching, if you have any questions, queries, comments regarding today's topic, which is the services which the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam rendered for the cause of Islam, then please don't hesitate to ask your questions. Inshallah, we'll be more than happy to welcome your questions or queries or comments into our program today. Jazakumullah for that, Anisa Sahiba. I'd like to come to one question here. Imtiazuddin Sahib from London emailed his question, and I'd like to pose this to the panel. He emailed his question and asked, first of all, he says, as a regular viewer, may I firstly add how much I enjoy your program. Jazakumullah for that, Imtiazuddin Sahib. His question is, my question is, are you able to explain in more detail the incident of the ink drops, the red ink drops, on which the on the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam's clothes, and what were the circumstances around this event, and do those particular clothes still exist? Shahzad Sahib, if you can please answer this.
Well, the Qasid, like all prophets of God, Allah the Almighty gives his prophets miracles, and these miracles are in fact for the believers especially, because they strengthen their faith. At the same time, they can also be a test for the non-believers as well. This particular incident that occurred, the ink drops, was with Hazrat Maulvi Abdullah Sunuri Sahib, who was a companion of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam. He was beside the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, and the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam was resting, and it was a it was a Friday, and it was Ramadan, and he thought to himself that how fortunate he is that it is the holy month of Ramadan,
and it was the last Friday,
and it was the last, and absolutely, it was a Jumatul Wida, and he said that how fortunate I am that I am in the holy month of Ramadan, and it is a Friday, and I'm beside the Prophet of God, the Messiah of the time. And he wished that may God show a miracle. And answering the humble call of his servant, Allah the Almighty showed this miracle. And Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, correct me if I'm wrong, was actually in a vision, was as if he was in front of Allah the Almighty, and God Almighty had flicked his pen, and the ink dropped. And that, in the room they were in, also this red ink dropped, and it was on the clothes of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, and on his feet as well. And Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam woke up, and obviously this, he immediately, they both knew exactly what happened, and he realized that his humble request, his prayer for a miracle had been fulfilled.
I think at first Hazrat Maulvi Abdullah Sahib Sunuri, he didn't actually know. The Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam didn't know, and Abdullah Sahib Sunuri reminded him that this is happening.
Abdullah Sahib first thought that it was a lizard, because
absolutely, in the subconscious, maybe something
some lizard
cut,
has been cut,
the blood has fallen. Yes, and so just keeping it brief, has he requested Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam if he could then have that particular the cloth that he was wearing on which this miraculous event occurred. And Hazur alayhi salatu wasalam gave him permission. He said that yes, he can have it, but like all prophets of God, as we had mentioned before, the very purpose of their advent is to free the world of shirk. So Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam said that yes, I will give it to you, but on one condition, and that is that when you pass away, then this particular cloth must be buried with you, and so that later on people will not take it, you know, again, not form a bid'at and start praying towards it or whatever, like other we see other Muslims do. So after, when he had passed away, that piece of cloth went with him. But this is a. He was buried with it. So, like I said, this was a just one of the many miracles that happened at the hand of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam.
And in fact, if we, I mean, this didn't go completely, you know, unseen. There is a picture of this for the benefit of the viewers. There is a picture of this of Hazrat Maulana Abdullah Sahib Sunori, in which he. You know, he's holding the kameez with him. In that picture, you can see the red ink drops for yourself as well.
And the room which it occurred in, as Kudusai was saying, that he maybe thought that it was a lizard or something like that, which it possibly could be the blood of that. Yeah. But actually, there was absolutely no other way that, those ink drops could have fallen. Mm-hmm. So it was a complete miracle of Allah the Almighty.
Exactly. If someone wants more information, they can read Tathkara as well, because it's mentioned in great detail there.
And in fact, many of the biographies of the Promised Messiah, Islam, you will find some in, on alislam.org. Namely, there is Ahmad the Guided One, and then there is one written by Mulan Abdurrahim Sabdard, which is quite a extensive biography, and inshallah you will find this incident to be there. Jazakumullah for that, gentlemen. Shahzad, if I can please turn to you once again. You also mentioned that due to the lack of knowledge at that time, prophets were being portrayed in a very, you know, inappropriate manner, and this became one of the reasons for which Islam was becoming a target for mockery. If you can please tell us explain this and how the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, you know, elaborated this further. If you can please tell us.
Because in the from the Holy Quran, Allah the Almighty states that "A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafizun." That it, surely we have sent down this book, and we are the ones who are going to protect it. Now, when we talk about the protection of the Holy Quran, we don't just mean the physical text of the Holy Quran, but in fact it's also in terms of its meaning as well. Because if the meaning was not going to be protected, then it defeats the whole purpose of protecting this book. Now, in accordance to this promise of God Almighty, we have seen, as the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had prophesied, that reformers will come at the head of each century, and one of their tasks was that, in light of the sciences that were being the new sciences that were being developed, and with the passage of time, as the prophecies of the Quran were being fulfilled, they were coming, these reformers, and interpreting the Quran and writing commentaries about it. This is one of the services that these reformers rendered. However, at the time of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, the so-called scholars of Islam actually posed the greatest threat to the Holy Quran. And it was as a result of these various commentaries and interpretations that they had done of the Holy Quran. And this, in fact, was bound to happen, because the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam had prophesied for almost 1400 years ago that وَأُولَمَاهُمْ شَرُّ مَنْ تَحْتَ دِينِ السَّمَاءِ, that the scholars of that time, the so-called scholars of that time, will be the worst individuals on the
worst
earth.
Worst creation
on the earth.
Yeah.
And it says that the fitna will spring forth from them. مِنْ إِنْدِهِمْ تَخْرَجُ وَالْفِتْنَ وَفِيهِمْ تَعُودْ. Now from them the fitna will spring forth, the chaos will spring forth, and within them it will return. And this is one of the examples that we see. It was this sheer disrespect and completely absurd interpretation that they were doing of the Holy Quran. So, according to this divine promise of Allah the Almighty, that He protects His book, Allah the Almighty provided those means that He sent His Messiah, and the 90 plus books that He wrote were in fact complementing the Quran, were in fact the commentary of the Holy Quran. And to illustrate this point, I'll mention one example of the Holy Quran and compare what their interpretation was like and what Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam presented. And theirs is such that sometimes it's even very uncomfortable to even to narrate that. But just for the benefit of the viewers, I'll tell them that there is a very famous incident in the Holy Quran of Hazrat Sulaiman and Malika Sabah, i.e. the Queen of Sheba. And the commentary that they have done is that, God forbid, that Hazrat Sulaiman wanted to marry the Queen Sheba, but he was told by someone that she has hair on her ankles. In order to investigate this, in order to find out whether this is true, he built a pathway in the palace of very clear glass slabs, and underneath it ran crystal clear water. And so when she came, thinking that it was water, she immediately raised her the clothes and of her ankles, and he was able to see. Now, this is their commentary of regarding a prophet of God. Now, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, who came as Hakam and Adal, and presented, you know, the Quran in a new light. Now, his interpretation is such that he said that Malika Sabah was a pagan. She, you know, they worshipped the sun and other heavenly bodies and the other stars. And in order to convince her that, you know, to believe in the Almighty God, he devised this method where he built this this pathway of glass slabs, and underneath ran the clear water. Mm. And she was a very intelligent woman, and so when she came, she realized straight away, thinking that first it was water, she raised the claws of her ankles, and then she realized immediately what Hazrat Sulaiman was actually trying to say. Mm. That just as we sometimes look at, well, as she was doing, was looking at the sun and considering that as to be the creator of everything, she realized that actually it was what's behind that, that the ultimate power behind that. Just like that, those glass slabs seemed as if they were the water, but the water was actually running underneath it. So this is just an example of the interpretation of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam did, and that in fact goes for all the other verses of the Holy Quran, which they've made absurd interpretations of. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam came and restored the sanctity and the noble character of all the prophets of Allah the Almighty.
JazakAllah for that, Shahzad Sahib. And obviously we're talking about the interpretation which the Prophet Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam did for the wrong concepts, the false concepts or the false notions which the Muslims were presenting or for some reason they had in their minds. I understand, and in fact we do have many non-Hamadi viewers, and we've got half an hour left. I would like to, you know, just put something out there for the benefit of our, for all our viewers, that if you honestly do think that there is any response to what the Prophet Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam has done, I mean, the Prophet Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam did not compromise Islam. He reformed Islam into today's society. If you think there was any possible, any better solution to doing this, then please, we're very interested to know and very intrigued if there is anyone out there who can challenge what the Prophet Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam has done. And in fact, we've been waiting for 124 years now, but no one has been answering this question. I'm sure no one will phone, but I would like to put this out there. If someone does have any better solution, then please, we'll be more than welcome to include that in our program today. We've received quite a number of questions. Zafar Sahib from London has texted in his question for Hatab, and he has asked, if Mirza Sahib was from God, then why did he start his task off by taking, by asking for funds from the elite of India?
First of all, I don't understand why somebody would raise this question, because of the fact that a prophet, it's never that a prophet is left on his own. A prophet's job is to reform the community around him. Mm. And Allah the Almighty clearly says that لَن تَنَالُ الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ, that you can never attain righteousness unless you spend out of that which is most beloved to you. And of course, as most people know, that wealth is one of the most beloved things to people. And the Prophet Messiah's job was not only to go out there on his own, his job was to bring the whole community along with him together. And for that reason, the Prophet Messiah himself knew that whatever happens, God Almighty will help him accomplish the task that he's given. But it was his job to involve the community that was around him, and especially the Muslims, of course, because that's whom the Promised Messiah ﷺ was sent for. And it always happens that material resources are always needed, even if it be for divine works. And that's what we see even in the time of the Holy Prophet ﷺ happening, that this is clearly manifest in the Sunnah. Even the Holy Prophet ﷺ, for instance, we take a look at the battles. Even at then, the Holy Prophet ﷺ made a call that whatever you have, bring it forward. And it will help you, not only will it help Islam, but it will help your personal state as well to reform you. And that's why you find even in the Holy Quran that it says that جَاهِدُوا بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ, that you should strive with your wealth and with yourselves. So this is in accordance with Islamic teachings, and I don't think there's any issue that should arise from asking for funds, because it not only reforms the person itself, but the Prophet's job is to reform the community around him, and that's...
We've done programs on this prior to this program about the funding and the chandajat, which is the correct term, in our community, and we've done programs on this in the past, recorded programs. You can refer to that, Zafar Sahib, for the rest of the viewers, but obviously I think that should suffice for now. But Zafar Saab, if that hasn't answered your question, then please do contact us, and inshallah we will answer your question from a different angle until you are satisfied. Jazakumullah for that, Farhad Saab. We've received some more questions now. Prior to going to them, we've received some emails before the program. I would like to pose them to our panel. Rehan Sahib from... Sorry, I'll put another question out. It's an anonymous question, but he asked that Ahmadis, as much as I know them, are generally good people, but why are there still some who give your community a bad name? Shahzad Sahib, you can please answer this.
Well, Qasid, the actions of few individuals doesn't mean that it actually, you know, it doesn't have an implication as such on the wider community. There are many Muslims who claim to be Muslims, and their actions are not in accordance to the teachings of the Holy Quran or the noble example of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that has no harm on Islam whatsoever. But like what is the concept of religion? What is the essence of religion? Is haqooqullah wa haqooqul ibad, that is to fulfill the rights of God and fulfill the rights of his fellow creation. And so obviously when we see our fellow brothers who have some certain blemishes in their character, or they are not acting in accordance to the teachings of Islam and the Holy Quran, then it is our responsibility, we have to shoulder that responsibility to bring them forward and to provide for their moral reformation. So if there are individuals, which obviously there are, that's the quality of being in a community and having a Khalifa, that you always have guidance and we always help each other and move forward.
Exactly, and in fact he's talking about, he says Ahmadis, as much as I know them, are generally good people. He's talking about Ahmadi Muslims. In my opinion, non-Ahmadi Muslims, as much as I know them, are generally good people as well. Humans are good people in general as well, but there is always, you know, a handful of people, selected few, who will put a bad name onto...
The current state of the Muslims are in today, it's not what the majority are doing, it's what the minority are doing. But the majority have to shoulder that responsibility and, you know, defend Islam and also reform these people as well.
And in fact the Jama'at's purpose, Khilafat Ahmadiyya, which is carrying on the promised Messiah's legacy, what his glory which he came into the world for, and obviously carrying on what Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to the world for, is to not just bring the spiritually reformed altogether into his Jama'at, but to bring those people who aren't so spiritually, for all people, you know, for the spiritually weak and for the spiritually pure as well, to bring them all together into a united community. And this is the purpose of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat. So obviously, you know, everyone has weaknesses, and this is our purpose, to bring everyone together and to try to, you know, cover our shortcomings and obviously work on these weaknesses.
Just to add a point, I mean, we're talking about community. I think the philosophy of prayer, of congregational prayer, is this very thing. That when you stand shoulder to shoulder to those people who are spiritually charged and those who are, say, spiritually weak, when you have this sort of community, this brotherhood, then automatically those who are spiritually weak, they are automatically drawn towards those who are spiritually enhanced. This is the true meaning of fastabiqul khairat, that to vie with each other in goodness. So this is the task of everyone, whoever is involved in a community, to help those brethren who are some sort are weaker in certain actions, by helping those those people who are better in some respect. So this is also the true meaning of fastabiqul khairat.
Jazakumullah for that, Qudus Sahib. Qudus Sahib, I'd like to pose the question to you now. Ammar Sahib from London texted in his question, and he asked, when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied the time period that was to elapse between him and the promised Messiah, did he include his own Khilafat years, i.e. the Khilafat-e Rashida, which was to follow him?
Jazakumullah Ammar Sahib. Yes, Hazur sallallahu alaihi wasallam did include the Khilafat-e Rashida, the rightly guided Khulafa, within his time period of the 1300 years from his time to the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam. There's a very famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he states, خَيْرُ الْقُرُونِ قَرْنِي, that the best of centuries is my century. ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يُلُونَهُمْ, then the century which comes after my century. ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يُلُونَهُمْ, then the century which comes after that. So Hazur stated 300 years like this. Then in the Quran, Hazur further mentions about Fajr Awaj, 1,000 years of corruption, 1,000 years of where the Muslim Ummah will itself go into a decline. And the actual commentary of this Fajr Awaj can be seen in a hadith where Hazur has mentions Khilafat as a whole, where he states that there will be Khilafat on the priesthood of prophethood, followed by such Khulafa that will be monarchs, then there will be monarchs who will be transgressing against the Ummah itself. Then there will be Khilafat on the precepts of Prophethood again. And this basically is a map of how the Muslim Ummah will look like within the 1300 years until the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam comes. And of course, we have the establishment of Mujaddidiyat as well, that Hazur prophesied, that the head of every century there will be a Mujaddid, a reformer, to reform the Muslim Ummah. And we find that this is mentioned in the hadith. If we want, we can read out the Arabic as well. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَبْعَثُ لِهَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ عَلَى رَأْسِ كُلَّ مِئَةِ سَنَةٍ مَنْ يُجَدِّدُ لَهَا دِينَهَا. That surely for my Ummah, for this Ummah, Allah will commission at the head of every century such reformers that will reform, that will rejuvenate the faith. So again, this is all a map, this is all an outline that the Prophet ﷺ prophesied until the coming of that Messiah. And from the Messiah onwards, there will be Khilafat until the Day of Judgment.
JazakAllah for that, Qudus Sahib. I'm not sure if I read this already, but I don't think I did. Imtiazuddin Sahib from Glasgow, he sent his email again, and he said, thank you for answering my question. It was a very inspiring response, so JazakAllah to the panel for answering that question. We received another message, a text message from Shabir, a very interesting text message from Shabir Sahib from Kuwait. I'm not sure if this is in response to what I said earlier, but it's quite a quick response. He's saying, those who don't believe in Mirza Ghulam Ahmed Sahib alayhi salatu wasalam, are they Muslims or not? Give me a yes or no. Shazad Sahib.
Well, Qazi Shabir Sahib's question reminds me of an incident where a particular Maulvi and someone were having a debate, and he asked the Maulvi Sahib, he said, Maulvi Sahib, have you stopped drinking alcohol? Now, for someone who's never had alcohol before, cannot give a yes or a no answer. It's an answer that requires a detailed response. So similarly is his question, that someone who doesn't believe in the Messiah, is he a kafir or not? You see, we have to study the Quran, we have to study the hadith, but I will make his job slightly more simple, and I'll present the facts and he can make the decision. Now, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, regarding the Imam Mahdi and the Messiah, said that فَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَبَايِعُوهُ وَلَوْ حَبْوًا عَلَى الثَّلْجَ فَإِنَّهُ خَلِيفَةُ اللَّهِ الْمَهْدِ. Now, when you see the Imam Mahdi, it is your job that even if you have to go on ice capped mountains, you must do the bayat at his hands. And we discussed this in the previous programs, that by stating that you have to go over ice capped mountains means that you have to go through every extent, through every hardship, to go and do the bayat at his hands. Then the Quran, regarding the khulafa that Allah the Almighty sends, and the Messiah is the Khalifa of God, says, وَمَنْ كَفَرَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. So these are the words of God. This is the hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The facts are before you. When Jamaat Ahmadiyya is not the only community that claims that Messiah was to appear or has appeared. Muslims unanimously believe that Messiah is going to come. The facts are here. When that Messiah comes and someone doesn't believe in him, what will your response be? Will he be a kafir, or will let them make that decision?
I'm actually quite pleased he's asking us whether we consider them Muslims, because they don't consider us Muslims. They completely chucked us out the pale of Islam in 1974. So it's very nice that he's actually bothered to ask what we think about Muslims.
Hazrat Masih Maud from day one has said that whoever recites the Kalima, says this Shahada, he is a Muslim.
Exactly.
Which is the practice of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyone who says the Kalima and says he is a Muslim, consider him to be a Muslim.
Exactly. Qudus.
Just as Shahzad said, that man talafaza Musliman, that write for me at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when there was a consensus being done at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all he stated that whoever claims to be a Muslim, just write his name down from amongst the Muslims. Do not ask any further question after that. This is the actual fundamental and bottom line about, and this is the principle that we should be following as well. We're not here to give any edicts of disbelief.
Absolutely.
It's not our right. It's not our job.
For that, Qudus Sahib. Farhad Sahib, coming back to our discussion, if I can come back to that, if you can tell us very briefly, time is quite short. There were some basic beliefs which were being altered in order to adapt Islam to the West's agenda. What was all this about, and what did Hazrat Masih Maud al-Islam do in this regard? In fact, if you can answer another question which is quite linked onto this. Adehan Sahib emailed his question recently, and he asked, although we claim that nobody at the time was serving Islam, however, we see that movements like the Aligarh movement did make a huge difference. How do we see this? If you can combine these two together and just...
To answer these questions, I think we need to briefly take a look at history, what history was telling us about that time. And that was a time when the West was coming into not coming into the East, but had come into the East. And the Muslims were seeing this, the West's influx and influence upon them, and they were realizing that these are a lot more advanced people than us, and we seem very backward with regards to, in comparison to the people that have come from the West. Now, seeing that, the Muslims realized that we must be doing something absolutely wrong, and especially the well-educated class, they were realizing that we're very backward people, and they were getting an inferiority complex, in fact. So many people started making reform movements, and one of those is Sir Sayyid Ahmed Khan, who started the Aligarh movement. But we see that these movements that started to make a reform, they started to misunderstand and misinterpret and compromise with some basic beliefs of the Holy Quran. Obviously they had the right intention of doing so, but because they didn't have the guidance of God Almighty, therefore they made mistakes, and they made big mistakes by compromising many basic beliefs of Islam. For instance, we take at Sir Sayyid Ahmed Khan Sahib's example, concepts such as revelation, concepts such as prayer, concepts such as angels. They were saying that these are not actually beings, but just powers. And they were saying that prayer doesn't actually have any effect anymore, because God has put in the place of, put in the system of destiny, and therefore prayer nothing can break that, and therefore prayer, you don't need to do any prayer, and doesn't actually have an effect. But the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, what he done in response to these people is that he corrected their mistakes. He appreciated that you're trying to make a reform, but you need to correct yourselves and accept the Imam of the time who's correcting you, and he's the actual one that is causing the reform. And he proved through his own example that, look, if you say prayer is not, doesn't have any effects, how is it possible that I am praying today and I'm receiving revelations from God Almighty about prophecies, and I'm making those prophecies and they are actually fulfilling them. God Almighty is fulfilling them as time proves it. So the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, in this way, not only proved the existence of God, not only proved the existence of angels, and also proved the reality and the effect of prayer as well.
Jazakumullah for that, Farhad Sahib. Ahmed Mansal Sahib from Ghana sent in his question via email, Qudus Sahib. He asked, what is the need of the reformer when the Quran and the Ahadith are with us?
Jazakumullah, Ahmed Sahib. Leaving the Quran and the Ahadith, the prophecies within them regarding the coming of a Messiah and reformers to one side, I'd like to just ask Ahmed Sahib that when we see after the life of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, a system of Khilafat was established, was there not job also to reform Islam and to keep Islam on the right path and keep Muslims on the right path? Whatever we give any sort of argumentation and, you know, make our answer sufficient for that regard, for Khilafat al-Rashida, that is the same reasoning and logic we can apply for the rest of the reformers that will come. Of course, like I said, the Quran and the Hadith of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam actually point towards a person coming, points towards the reformers coming at the head of every century, which we presented before as well. And as for the time, Shazad mentioned that there was so much corruption in the land, that Allah the Exalted himself states that whenever there is such corruption within the land, then it is his responsibility, it is out of his mercy that he sends a prophet, sends a reformer into the world. So we can all feel the need, we can all feel that there is corruption in the land, and there was one solution, which is Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian alayhi salatu wasalam.
In fact, Ahmed Mansa Sahib, for your benefit, Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih, in his recent Friday sermon on the 19th of April 2013, just spoke of this, and I mentioned this in the introduction. He mentioned what is the need of the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam in this day and age. And towards the last half an hour, in fact, Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih spoke on this topic very emphatically and spoke on why there is a need, despite there being the perfect teachings. And we've been speaking about this, in fact, in previous programs, but do refer to Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih's Friday sermon last week, this Friday, and inshallah you will receive your answer in that. Qudus Sahib, very briefly, this is the last part of our discussion now. I mean, there is an allegation that Hazrat Masih Maud al-Islam, the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, he wrote many books covering about 20 volumes, but he didn't write a single book on you know, the commentary of the commentating on the Holy Quran at Tafsir. If you can very briefly tell us, we only have a few minutes left.
I think throughout the program we've been mentioning the services of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, for the Islam, for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and the Holy Quran itself. And to someone to say that he or Hazur authored no commentary, in my opinion, is clearly misinformed. Every word that Hazur spoke, Qasid, every conduct, every moral that he showed, and every action that he took was in fact a commentary of the Holy Quran itself. But coming back towards the allegation itself, I think it should be made really clear that all those books, every letter that Hazur wrote, every word that Hazur wrote, in actual fact, was the commentary of the Holy Quran. Those 23, the set of 23 volumes known as Ruhani Khazain, every page has the commentary of the Quran, has a commentary of the Ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you know they're available on Al-Islam. There are many translations of different books as well. Yeah. As you said, to make it short, yeah, I'll just present one book from it. The first book is known as Brahine Ahmadiyya. Mm. As Shahzad mentioned as well, that this book was a great, it was a need for the time, and it discussed so many things, for example, the existence of God itself and other various topics as well. It basically proved the exalted status of Islam compared to other religions. It proved that the religion of Islam is alive as compared to other religions as well, and that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Khatam al-Nabiyyin, and why he's Khatam al-Nabiyyin. And Hazur proved it through logical and rational ideas. Every word that Hazur wrote within this book itself shows the greatness of the Quran, shows the greatness of Islam, and shows the greatness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Mm. If you do not call this a commentary, then what do you call it?
Exactly. Jazakumullah for that, Qudus Sahib. And for the benefit of our viewers, we saw great benefit from a book of Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih II. It's called Masih Maud alayhi salam ki karname. It's in Urdu, but for the benefit of the Urdu reading people, this would obviously, the viewers, it would be greatly beneficial. For those of you who aren't aware of the with the Urdu language, then you can get help from the Urdu speaking people within our Jamaat. In this book, this book is included within Anwar al-Ulum, the set of books of and the speeches of the promise of Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih II. He speaks about the various works of the promised Messiah with regards to Islam especially. And he's only stated 15, but 15 he's expanded on it greatly and immensely in a magnificent way, and it is a very good read, and especially with regards to the Quran, the Ahadith, and the world at large, what services he rendered and what he has to offer, what the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat has to offer. You can go to Al-Islam and inshallah you will find this in the books in the library, in the Urdu books, and you can read this there. This is a great read, like I said, and we benefited from this greatly in preparing for our program. Shahzad Sahib, if you can please tell us, we have one question remaining. In fact, we have Mujib Khan Sahib from the United States, but I believe we may not have enough time to include that in our program. But just before we finish, we received an anonymous questioner's question, who asked, "You arrange the conferences yourself?" I think he's referring to the various events that we talk about. Who else invites your leader? If you can please answer this.
Well, Qasid, he's absolutely right. He or she. We do arrange these various events, you see, because the tradition and the practice of the community is completely in accordance with the Holy Quran and the noble example of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we see from the life of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that when he was invested with the task that, you know, he now had to propagate this message that Allah the Almighty had given him. And the Quran says that fasda bima tu'mar, that openly announce this now message to the whole of the mankind. And we see that the very first time he invited his family and his close friends, he actually invited them to his own house. He prepared a meal for them, and after that he then invited them to the message of Islam. So our practice is completely in accordance to that. And as we were mentioning earlier in our discussion, that we have to shoulder this responsibility. You see, the minority or very small set of Muslims may the so-called Muslims may do so, have through certain actions may give Islam a bad name, but it's the job of the Muslims to shoulder that responsibility and be the torchbearers of establishing peace and giving the true message of Islam. So yes, we do. This is the jihad of this day and age. You know, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said that the time of the Messiah you know, there will be all stop to all kinds of jihad with the sword. So this is the jihad that we are doing. We are investing a lot of money, and yes, we are going to the Houses of Parliament, to Capitol Hill, to the European Parliament. We are going to those places where, you know, people make decisions at an international level, and we are telling them the message of Islam and giving them the message of peace and how peace can be established. But, you know, if in the eyes of those who we are considered as non-Muslims, then the question is, what are the Muslims then doing? They have all the money, they have all the resources. How many conferences have they held? How many of them have gone to the, you know, the intellectuals and those influential people and given them the message of Islam? And so obviously we are completely in accordance with the noble example of the Holy Prophet ﷺ. And it's not, you know, to say that it's only we only organize these events. In fact, there was only a recent example when the London mayor actually invited Hazur himself and commended him for the efforts that the community is making, and also in Canada,
Premier of Ontario.
Absolutely, he, you know, Hazur didn't have time to come to him, so he brought the function to closer to Hazur and invited Hazur to attend.
Definitely, Jazakumullah for that, Shahzad Sahib. And obviously, a lot more can be said on this. I'll have to apologise to Mujib Khan Sahib from the United States and Saheed Sahib from Nigeria, who texted us his question. Inshallah, we will aim to answer your question in the next program in 2 weeks' time. Inshallah. Alhamdulillah, in today's program we spoke about the services which the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam rendered for the cause of Islam. But when we say that he served Islam in the best possible way which anyone had served Islam, we have to understand the state of that time in which he appeared, because the magnificence of his services can only be fully appreciated once we take into account the atmosphere at that time. Because at that time, the world was entering one of the biggest revolutions which humankind has ever faced, when the creation, the products of humans were to lead and were to control humans themselves. And humans were being subject to this very control. As well as that, the Muslims were in dire need of a reform, and we see that various, as our panelists discussed today, there were various reform movements which were being initialized just because of this very fact, that there was need for reform. So fulfilling these two problems, these two issues, with one solution, God Almighty sent to the world Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian alayhi salatu wasalam, in complete subservience to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And we see that he continued with this work and reformed Islam in the best possible way in the modern day. And Khilafat Ahmadiyya, the glory of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, still lives today, and it is over 100 years that the five successors of the Promised Messiah have flourished, have spread Islam, propagated Islam to the corners of the world in the best possible way in the modern day and age. Inshallah, in the next program, I mean, obviously, towards the end of the program, we discussed some of the events which Hazrat Khalifatul Masih, the Supreme Head of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, has attended. We will talk about this further, inshallah, in the next program. And because obviously this is a continuation, like I said, of what the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam is doing. And inshallah, the next program is on the 5th of May 2013, not next week, but the week after, inshallah. From all of us here, I mean, we didn't receive any answer from any of our non-Ahmadi brethren, but inshallah, I hope to receive some answers during the week. Inshallah, until then, from all of us here at Beacon of Truth, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
करके छोड़ेंगे हम हक को आशकार रूए जमी को खा हिलाना पड़े हमें जाएंगे हम जहां बिके जाना